For example, I was talking to some lawyers, my friends, my theory about the case. I said once, I believe there are very strong connections between Samtoro Ding and Malatya murders, and I believe they were planned and carried out by Turkish Gladio. And then a week later, I got a telephone call from some newspapers in Taraf, from some newspapers in Istanbul. They said, there is a weird guy here. He has a chart in his hand, and he said, there are connections between Samtoro Ding and Malatya cases, and they all carried out by Turkish Gladio. And he said he has the organizational structure of Turkish Gladio, and your name was on top of that. So they started to send me messages like this, and I understood this. I think the message was so clear, something like this: okay, you think you are a clever guy? Okay, you are a clever guy. You understood. You understand the network, but you are just an insect for us. We can toy with you. You are just nothing for us. We can mock you, you know. In 2007, there were so many threats. There were so many attacks against Christians, non-Muslims, and intellectuals. So many prominent figures started to walk around by bodyguards, provided by them, by the newspapers, by security directorate, etc. So it was a very dangerous atmosphere, and there was this just fresh murders, you know, Santoro Dinkman. So when I get this, of course I got this. I got the message. It was such a clear threat, you know. It was such a clear threat. They even bothered themselves sending someone to Istanbul, because I didn't not only get this from Istanbul. Some journalists also called me from Ankara. Exactly the same guy visited them in Ankara also. Showed the same chart, organizational structure, etc. And it was just the beginning. It was just the beginning. And I said, I have two avenues. One, I will leave this case here, or I will continue and I will go to the very end. And I decided to do this, actually. Then their messages continued. Second time, they sent a very complicated letter to the court in which they claimed that I organized these murders. And then there was a list of people who will be assassinated. They said, these people will also be assassinated by the cell, you know, which was directed by this guy, Orhan Kemal Cengiz. And I look at the names, and it was so terrible because they were all in danger. I mean, these Kurdish leaders, etc. There was a list there. My understanding is that they were trying to a couple of things at the same time. One, they were trying to manipulate the court. They were trying to create all this fuss around the case, because there were some other serious informal letters in the case, and they were giving the message to the court, something like this, you know. Even the lawyers of the victims can be accused. Anyone can be accused. There was a second message to me, because there were so many private messages in this letter that could only be understood by myself. There were some reference to my, let's say, my personal relations 5, 10 years ago. So I understood that I had always been followed by these guys. They had a lot of information about me, and they were using against me. Third, I understood this. They were trying to create a kind of disinformation surrounding my name. And this is a classical tactic of Turkish Gladio, or Turkish Deep State in Turkey. Before killing, they did this many times. Before killing intellectuals, they created this kind of things, you know. Oh, he's getting food from this, he has these connections with that. And then when he was killed, people were confused. Oh, this guy killed, but he had so many connections, etc. So I understood that something was unfolding. And then they started to send me private messages. Very complicated problems. And then I started to get telephone calls. And I said, it is enough. It is coming. You know, it is so clear. They were going to kill me. This was my analysis. And they were just trying to create this information about my name. And then I applied to the prosecutor here. And then I talked to people from Amnesty International. They take it very seriously. They have a lot of experience. They look at the file, they take it, and they started a global campaign about this. And then I was given a bodyguard, etc. And then the case still continues. And after 4 years, we came to this point that all this gendarmerie intelligence, all this JITEM, all these people were behind the scenes. And the prosecutor is in Malatya case is just preparing to launch a new set of indictment in which he indicted all this local media, etc. And I haven't mentioned to you when we went there, my photos all on local newspapers, as if I was a criminal. They were showing me as a target. You know, who is this guy? He's just trying to put dirt on the name of Malatya, something. They were so provocative news coverages. It stopped after Ergenekon case. When Ergenekon case started to get serious dimensions, they stopped. And I believe not only against me, against many intellectuals. So this is one of our difficulties in Turkey. There are so many shortcomings, problems in Ergenekon case. But on the other hand, we have this very concrete reality. After Ergenekon case, when Ergenekon case got some progress, they stopped because they paralyzed. They started to concern their future about Turkey. They stopped their operations because they couldn't work so freely as they used to do before. And I believe in Malatya case we are more lucky than them because we forced too much the court, and maybe we were lucky, there were some coincidences, etc. And we are about to connect the case to the right directions. But in Hrant Dink case, if you look at for the last four years, they haven't gone anywhere. Because the problem here, there were so many things happening around the case. But people just look at the files. There was nothing in the files. When you look at the file of Malatya massacre, you see five youngsters, ultra-nationalists, religious, blah, blah. You know, they were so angry with Protestants. They decided to punish them, etc. But if you look at what was happening in Malatya before the incident, this campaign, you know, what kind of conferences Malatya Inan University held, anti-missionary activities of Malatya Gendarmerie, they spent, I mean, in Malatya there were just 20 missionaries, so-called missionaries. They spent maybe 40 million lira to follow the activities of so-called missionaries. This is officially spent money by the gendarmerie. So if you don't look at this, you cannot understand. I mean, because there is nothing in the files. This files was prepared by the police and given to them. My theory is that not only for Malatya case, for Hrant Dink case and Malatya case, unfortunately, this illegal unit of gendarmerie, I believe, prepared the groundwork. They prepared everything. But also, police intelligence put a complete blind eye on everything. It is impossible for them to not to see that this ultra-nationalist group were trying to penetrate a handful Protestants community whose all activities had been watched so closely. It is impossible. So this is, I think, our problem. And how can we test this? My theory, after Malatya massacre, police stopped in Samsun. Similar murders were stopped, were prevented in Samsun, in İzmir, in Diyarbakır, in Mersin, and in some other cities. My theory is that police intelligence was watching what gendarmerie, illegal units of gendarmerie was doing. They knew everything, but they were not concerned with this because they were also under the influence of this huge propaganda. Missionaries, etc. They were not concerned themselves. It is not like Ergenekon case. Like it or not, there is a huge flow of information in Ergenekon case. Because in Ergenekon, you know, there is a clear segment that, okay, this Turkish military and some secular elites was doing something. But in Hrant Dink and Malatya case, there is the involvement of the police by not acting on intelligence. So they have their own shame on their hands. So as a result, we didn't have any flow of information in this case. So there was nothing. There was nothing in the court files. Nothing. We pushed so much. We pushed so much the court. We work on every single detail, etc. And then we were lucky, maybe, there was this informer, a guy within the gendarmerie. He came forward. He's a secret or confidential witness right now, but we know who he is. He came forward and he said, I was given this task by my superiors, that they instructed me to go into the Protestant community, to work there as a priest, okay? And it is unbelievable. This guy went into the Protestant community, worked there, even he became pastor, a religious leader. He was doing so-called missionary propaganda. And then he got a second order from his superior. They said, okay, you will become a Muslim now. And then he became Muslim, he enlightened, and then he started to go all these television channels with some theologian professors, and he started to appear on television every single day. He was doing all this propaganda, and it was the commencement of this attack, if you ask me. All this attack followed this huge black propaganda that was carried out by this guy and so-called professors on television, because they were portraying Turkey as if it was invaded by Protestants. And this guy, luckily, came forward and told this story to prosecutor and wanted to benefit from this so-called legal provisions of becoming a confessor. This was one of the turning points in our case, and then the Ergenekon prosecutor started working on his statements and other things, and then they sent all this file to Malatya prosecutor, and Malatya prosecutor now is in the process of preparing a new indictment, which will include all these details, and then of course the case will gain new dimensions. You are just nothing for us. We can mock you, you know. In 2007, there were so many threats. There were so many attacks against Christians, non-Muslims, and intellectuals. So many prominent figures started to walk around by bodyguards, provided by them, by the newspapers, by secret messages like this. And I understood this. I think the message was so clear, something like this. Okay, you think you are a clever guy? Okay, you are a clever guy. You understood. You understand the network, but you are just an insect for us. We can toy with you. You are just I mean, for example, I was talking to some lawyers, my friends, my theory about the case. I said once, I believe there are very strong connections between Samtora Dink and Malatya murders, and I believe they were planned and carried out by Turkish Gladio. And then a week later, I got a telephone call from some newspapers in Taraf, from some newspapers in Istanbul. They said there is a weird guy here. He has a chart in his hand, and he said there are connections between Samtora Dink and Malatya cases, and they all carried out by Turkish Gladio. And he said he has the organizational structure of Turkish Gladio, and your name was on top of that. So they started to send